Good morning, everyone. Today we are in Ezekiel chapter 32. And as we examine chapter 32 this morning, we once again have a lamentation that is being brought toward Pharaoh, the king of Egypt, by God through Ezekiel, and that is going to foretell and is going to talk about what is going to happen when Egypt falls to the Babylonians. Now, again, Egypt is one of the prominent nations of this particular day and time, and they have been the enemy of the Babylonians for quite some time in all of this. And to this point, they have survived and even thrived in various ways in going up against the Babylonians. But God says it's not going to be the case any longer. As a matter of fact, at the start of chapter 32, he talks about them being like a lion and like a sea monster as far as those kinds of things go. But then he says in verse 9, he says, I will also trouble the hearts of many peoples when I bring your destruction among the nations into the countries which you have not known. Yes, I will make many peoples astonished at you, and their kings shall be horribly afraid of you when I brandish my sword before them, and they shall tremble every moment, every man for his own life in the day of your fall. Egypt is going to fall. Egypt is going to fall in such a way and to such a degree that even nations that don't really know them are going to hear about it and are going to tremble. And the reality is, the message that's going to be sent out is, if Egypt can fall, anyone can fall. They're going to tremble, God says, every moment, every man for his own life in the day of your fall. Because if Egypt, which is one of the most powerful nations at this time, if Egypt is going to fall, then who is going to be able to stand? Who's going to be able to make it through the conquest of the Babylonians or the hand of God coming against them? And so this is going to be very much a sounding board of the power of God and also of the work of the Babylonians, that who is going to be able to stop them? Because as we talked about in the last chapter, you're not just going to have Egypt. She's not standing by herself. She's got all of her allies with her, and yet she's still going to fail in this endeavor to stop the Babylonians. And so you have this idea that they will be known throughout the world, and that their failure, their loss, is going to be heard throughout the world. And it's going to cause others to tremble, because where they have failed, for others there is no hope of success. You drop down to verse number 18, and you then have the beginning of this second message here in Ezekiel chapter 32. And he says, Son of man, wail over the multitude of Egypt, and cast them down to the depths of the earth, her and the daughters of the famous nations, with those who go down to the pit. Now, the idea of the pit, as it's utilized here, is the idea of death or destruction. And so Egypt is going to get cast down to the pit. As you go through the remainder of the chapter, there are going to be a number of different utilizations of this particular phraseology. As a matter of fact, it's going to be very repetitive in its nature, and it's going to be done for a couple of reasons. The first one is, God is showing Egypt they are no greater than the nations that have been destroyed before them. You're going to see Assyria mentioned. You're going to see Elam mentioned. You're going to see various others that are going to be brought up over the course of the last half of this chapter. And they all went down to the pit. They all faced their destruction. Assyria, being one of the largest and strongest among those listed, is only going to have fallen over the previous 30 years or so prior to this particular statement. So it's still relatively fresh in the minds of the Egyptians, and it will be the first one that is mentioned. The idea here also is, in verse 19, God says, Whom do you surpass in beauty? Go down, be placed with the uncircumcised. You're going to see this idea of the uncircumcised many times over in this particular area as well. And the idea of uncircumcised, generally we think of to be the statement of a reference to Gentiles. And while there is a sense in which that is being utilized in that way, it goes a little bit deeper than that, in that it seems to be a statement about their relationship with God, not just their physical nationality. And so when he's talking about them being uncircumcised, he's talking about them being without or being outside of God. They have been cast down to the pit as those who are uncircumcised, as those who are without God. And so you have this picture that is being painted. It's a repetitive picture. It's almost like a rotating picture that keeps coming around with a different nation each time. And it is a picture of death and destruction. It is a picture of what is going to happen to Egypt that has already happened to nations round about them. And he says, verse 31, Pharaoh will see them and be comforted over all his multitude, Pharaoh and all his army slain by the sword, says the Lord God. For I have caused my terror in the land of the living, and he shall be placed in the midst of the uncircumcised with those slain by the sword, Pharaoh and all his multitude, says the Lord God. Egypt is going to fall. When she does, the whole world is going to know about it. Or at least those from great distances are going to know about it. But also, when she does, she is going down to the pit, like the other nations that have gone before her, who do not know God. And those are the lessons of Ezekiel chapter 32. Now, to make application to us, the same thing holds true today when it comes to God's judgment. If we do not know him, and not just know who he is, because these other nations knew who he was, but to know him from the sense of being obedient to him, to know him from the sense of understanding what his will for us is and being willing to do it, we can face the same kind of destruction. It may not be physical destruction, but God promises a judgment that all men have to endure and that all men will have to go through to see the deeds that they have done, whether they be good or whether they be evil. And we need to be as mindful of that as Pharaoh is having to face these things in his day. These are the things from Ezekiel chapter 32. Next time we will come back and we will begin our study of Ezekiel 33. Until then, have a great day.